All right, it's Dev Shapiro here with C-League Film News, and if you could introduce yourself and the film that you're screening here at the festival.
My name is Sean Colon, and I am screening A Fat Wreck.
Tell us a little bit about this film.
A Fat Wreck is a documentary about the punk rock record label Fat Records, really popular in the mid to late 90s. We do recreations of events that happen with puppets that we had made, so it's a little bit different than the traditional way of doing reenactments. The movie focuses on some of the where the label came from, and kind of its ethos and its sense of community and its impact, that the cultural impact it had.
Could you tell us a little bit about the record label? Because, you know, in the mid to late 90s, you had, you know, it was mostly West Coast rap. You had Death Row Records. Eazy-E passed away in 95, so, you know, most of the music was centered on that. And then, you know, going on to the pop side, you had Britney Spears and people like that. So, you know, punk rock is not something that is, you know, was really mainstream back then. Everyone was talking either about, you know, West Coast rap here in the South, or they were talking about, you know, the pop music, because, you know, Britney was from Louisiana.
I'll probably disagree with you there. A little band called Green Day totally dominated the time period, which created a whole wave of pop punk. In fact, one of the reasons the label was so successful is because Nirvana broke, when Nirvana broke, that kind of like paved the way for independent rock acts to kind of come to the surface, because you had Michael Jackson at the top of the charts. So after you had that initial wave of Nirvana, then you had and the grunge stuff, which had its roots in punk rock. Then you had the Southern California boom of all like Green Day, Rancid, who was another big one? You know, all your, I'm trying to think, what were the other big ones from then?
All the big ones, Scott
Vance. Yeah, all Scott Vance. NoFX. So there was definitely the hip hop stuff going on, which I would say dominated.
Right.
It was much larger. But as far as the punk scene in general, its biggest time was during the 90s, where it really became mainstream, and you had a Hot Topic selling punk rock shirts, and it really became this kind of a cultural thing, maybe not at the same level, obviously, as like Death Row Records and some of the hip hop stuff that was going on. But as far as that in the rock world, I guess you'd say pop punk kind of Blink-182 came out of all that,
right?
You know, that kind of stuff. So
all right, okay, I can, you know, see that and agree with you on that. So tell us a little bit about this record label. What set it apart? How did it get started? You know, what was some of their big acts that we may or may not know?
I think what sets it apart is the fact that it rejected the MTV model early on, and was, you know, they were selling hundreds of thousands of records, and in the independent space, that's quite a bit, you know, to be able to sell hundreds of thousands of records.
And this was right, this was before MP3s, you know, Napster just came on the scene, so it was a lot harder for, you know, for people to really get into the independent record label, because you literally had to sell the stuff out of your trunk.
Well, and what they did is they did a mail order, and what I think one of the keys, and we focused a little bit on the movie, the keys to success was these compilations they did. They sold them for like $1 or $3. They would really put them together, not just slap bands together in general, but really kind of order the songs kind of like an album. And that really connected in a lot of different areas. And like you said, before MP3s, before the internet, so it was all really mail order, and you would have these little communities that would pop up around this kind of music. And we were out here in Texas, you know, we're Dallas, Texas here, and we're making a movie about the Southern California punk rock label because of all our friends got into it, and it shaped the direction of our lives and our ethics and our politics, and really played a role in the people we became. And when I started making the movie and, you know, putting things out publicly, the thing I heard back a lot was, thank you for making this movie. There's like, this had a big impact on my life. So it wasn't, I think the amount of people is less than some things that have happened culturally, but I think the intensity of it is higher. And the people who are into it, they have carried it with, like me, I'm 35, they've carried it for 25 years and are just as psyched about it. Like, I mean, the amount, I've had doctors in Germany send me money for the movie, and these are guys that have made their ways up into, you know, the regular walks of life, but still carry that thing that they really love. So, yeah.
So where would you find, you know, you said mail order, so was there a particular magazine or public access show or a radio station that you would find out about this?
I would say Razor Cake was a big one that was kind of a zine that was Maximum Rock and Roll. These are like kind of underground kind of things, but they would make their way through the networks. And even those, it was before MP3s. In the mid-90s, you were still starting to have like BBSs. And so you have these communities, you know, dorks, you know.
Listservs and stuff like that.
Right. And so you'd have a way for people to find out about it. And going to punk rock shows, I mean, that's how I would go. I'd go to punk rock shows, get the albums, and on the back of the albums, they would have a thank you list. And they would thank all these different bands. And you would go look and find out who those bands were. And so you'd develop these networks that way. And the other thing was, like the Fat Records kind of were talking about what set it apart was they kind of had a certain sound. And so it was real easy. If something came out on Fat Records, you would usually go and buy it because you're like, oh, it's a Fat Records band. It's probably going to be really good.
The quality. The quality
and the vibe and the a certain sound. So you kind of knew what to expect, you know.
So starting off in production, where did you start? Who did you contact out on the West Coast to get, you know, into the archives of this company? And tell us some about some of the stories and trials and tribulations you went through.
Sure. Well, I'd only done a few music videos and like a behind the scenes documentary kind of thing. And I decided that I wanted to do a project to learn how to do film type stuff. And I decided, I was looking around, there wasn't a Fat Records documentary. It was something I was pretty passionate about. And so I'm like, well, I'll do a Fat Records documentary from the fans' perspective. You know, a 20-minute short, just to kind of learn how to do it. And so I just really kind of started doing it. I went out to Punk Rock Bowling in 2013, and me and my wife on a vacation. I took a camera and some gear, had absolutely no idea what I was doing, and just started shooting. And I really had no idea what I was doing. Looking back, you know, how much I've learned from now to then, I really didn't know my ISO from my f-stop. But I did cut a little trailer, and this kind of whole thing kind of snowballed. I cut a little trailer and kind of, it happened organically. And when I cut that trailer, people got excited about it and started contacting me. And then I had something I could send out to the label and say, hey, I'm gonna release this. It's more of kind of a naivete. Let me just put it that way. I was naive in how everything worked. So I just kind of started doing it and said, hey, I'm letting you know that I'm doing this. I'm gonna release it tomorrow. And they were like, the main guy was like, looks cool. So I took that as tacit approval. And then over the course of the few months, I started developing relationships. And in 2014, we did Indiegogo to go out to California and raise like $7,500. And we hit that in the first 24 hours. And over the course of the campaign, ended up raising $30,000, which took it from a 20-minute short to a feature-length film. And at that point, because of the success of that, it got us even bigger interviews, and we did two big trips out to California, and we did over 120 interviews total. And from within this scene, we talked to all the major players, I'd say.
You seem pretty passionate about this. You know, for me, I grew up with Ruthless Records, NWA, Death Row. You know, Straight Outta Compton just came out. Some of the stuff that I didn't know really shocked me. You know, you seem to be the same type of person that, you know, did your research and stuff as a young kid, you know, first going around on this. So my question to you is there anything that really shocked you that you didn't know, that you really learned while doing this documentary and talking with the movers and shakers?
I think the biggest thing for me is when I started, the main person that is kind of figurehead of Fat Records is this guy, Fat Mike. It's kind of where the name comes from. He's in this band called NoFX, which they've sold over 8 million records, and they're an independent band, so they're widely known. And he is a controversial figure in a lot of ways. He promotes late adult drug use. Like starting doing drugs when you're once you're responsible and you've done everything in your life, then you can do drugs kind of thing, which is kind of controversial. He was at South by Southwest, did this thing where he faked peeing in a thing and made everybody drink it. And he got banned from South by Southwest and then released a video showing that he had faked it into a Switch. And so he's this guy that everyone kind of, when they think about records, they think this is the guy. The biggest thing that I found out was the main person that makes things happen is Aaron.
Okay.
Which was his wife at the time when they started the record label. They got divorced but still do the label together. She day to day, she's the one who manages the label. She's the one that, you know, makes sure the records go out. He kind of signs the bands. It's like the creative type. She's the
operations.
Yeah, and that was the biggest surprise for me, because going in, I didn't know who I needed approval from, and I got approval from him, I thought, and I realized there's a whole group of people that are really just doing the hard work. And I think showing that to Fat Records fans was exciting. So like, look, this is something not everyone really knows, because she's not someone who likes the spotlight. It actually took me 11 months to get her to agree to do an interview.
Wow. So, you know, I'm looking at your postcard here, at the artwork on your poster. So you have puppets, and it kind of reminds me of Crank Yankers. So talk to us about your puppets, and talk to us about, you know, did Crank Yankers influence you to do that? What's his name?
This is Fat Mike.
All right.
This is the puppets are all recreations of the actual people in the that are being interviewed. That way we could, as they're telling interesting stories, kind of recreate those. It was it came about organically as well. One of the bands on the label, Bad Cop, Bad Cop, the lead singer, she's an artist and has done murals for like Parks and Recreation, and also some background artwork for Adult Swim shows. After a concert, when we filmed them and done an interview, she said, "Hey, I do all kind of stuff, but I make puppets if you're interested." And it's like, I was like, "That's it. That's our thing. That's a way that we can tell the story that it's interesting, it's different, but it's also fun." And then we went about figuring out how we're gonna do. I wanted the main puppets to look as lifelike as possible, and then we have another smaller tier. All in all, we had about 12 puppets made.
I imagine that took a big chunk of your budget, because looking at this puppet in person, it's high quality.
It was that, and the animation in the film were definitely things that I pushed for. I knew that they had to be there, so you kind of figure out a way to make things happen. We were able to compensate the puppet makers. I think we got a hell of a deal. They were thousands of dollars, but for the level of quality and the, I don't know if we're listening or seeing, but the intricacies.
Yeah, I mean, it's high quality.
These are exactly the tattoos he has.
Oh, wow.
Like, down to the T. I mean, it's, he would say that his eyebrows aren't as big, but they kind of. I was really excited about it. Crank Yankers is what you asked about.
Right.
Yes, that was the way that they, when they were talking and they kind of did that, I liked that. And also Drunk History.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen Drunk History?
Yeah.
So the when they're telling the story, that's what we want to do with the puppets. There's not a voice of Fat Mike. Sometimes it's this interview person saying what Mike said. Sometimes Mike saying what he said. But it kind of, it's the puppets are voicing what the interview person is saying. So it lays on top of the story they're telling.
So I've been told by someone, I won't say, but I've been told that this film is very vied for, that people wanted this film to be in their film festival. But you wanted to screen this film first at the Angelica because you happen to live down the street from this movie theater. So tell me about what it really means to you to have this film screened down the street from you at a movie theater that you've been to hundreds of times.
Well, I mean, not only just the Angelica, which is amazing, but being a part of the Dallas Film Festival. 5 years ago, when me and my wife were first dating, my now wife, she got us tickets to go to the Dallas Film Fest, first time I had gone to a film fest. So we did 5 passes. Next year we did 10 passes. And then the year after that, a client of mine got me not a star pass, but a
filmmaker pass.
A pass.
Right.
So I got to experience that. And then the year after that, the company I was working for was a community partner. So I presented a film and got the star pass, where I got to go everywhere. And I really like that.
So you're hooked.
And then the year after that, I wanted to be involved again, and the movie was still in the works, so I came and I volunteered and got to see, you know, I did ushering, and I, you know, worked with the amazing staff, became friends with a lot of the people here, and this year to be as a filmmaker,
Let's talk about that, because, you know, I've been in the film festival world for about 10, 12 years. And filmmakers often ask me, how do I get a film in the film festival? So how important was it to you that you volunteered? Did you learn a lot on what was accepted, what wasn't, how to do your film?
To be honest with you, I it wasn't necessarily about getting the film into the festival. I felt like I wanted to be, because I had been a part of it at some level already, I wanted to be a part of the community and contribute in a way. And at the level that I was working, I didn't really see about the programming and things like that. I was really seeing how the festival works at its, you know, on the ground level, where and how they treat their volunteers, how organized they are, and really see how a film festival, because Dallas Film Fest is highly regarded, so I wanted to see how they were done and get a vibe for every aspect of it, you know. And like I said, I wanted to be involved, so I wasn't sure if my movie was going to get in. You know, you never know.
But you felt your experience was important to understand the film festival world.
Right. Like I said, just being involved, you know, I think is. And I got to see a bunch of movies. Yeah.
That's the point, yeah.
That's the secret. You come, I mean, I've, anybody listening, volunteer at a film festival. And bust your ass. But even when you bust your ass, you're going to get to see a bunch of great movies and hang out with other people who are really into film. I mean, that's the other cool thing, you know?
So you're screening this film here at the Dallas International Film Festival. This film, you know, I hope gets, you know, accepted into other film festivals. It's really talked about on the circuit this year. So beyond the film festival circuit, what are your hopes? Theatrical release, cable, video on demand, Netflix. What is your hopes and your...
First, I want to thank you for saying that nice thing about the movie. That's good to hear that people are, you know, one of the things about getting into a film festival isn't going and meeting the people and finding how it works. I think really one of the main things is making a film that you're as good as you can, that you're passionate about. But as far as distribution is concerned, we hope to kind of do a little punk rock kind of model where we want to do festival screenings as many as we can.
So down and dirty.
Down and dirty, and then do a tour it, and
nice.
do maybe you know a road show, and I mean some of our most avid fans are in Japan and Germany. In Australia and places like that. So we want to get the film out there as much as we possibly can. Maybe do some screening over the summer and get the people who are really passionate about it get to see in the theater. It's in 5.1. There's some really... The animation and the 5.1...
It has to be seen on the screen.
It's really... I mean, even our aspect ratio was done in a way to make it seem epic. I wanted to take a thing that was kind of a small thing and show how epic it is. And also, if you're a Fat Records fan, seeing it with other fans, there's going to be moments where you're like, ah! You know? So, and you're going to turn to your buddy and be like, holy crap, they got so-and-so, you know? Because that's how... I mean, that's when I was making the movie, I wanted it for me.
So you say there's going to be a whole lot of holy crap so-and-so moments.
I think so. I think there's some people that we got in the movie that if you're a real fan of some of these bands, there's some people that don't do a lot of interviews, and they agreed to do interviews for us, which was really great. You know?
That's awesome.
So then later in the year, hopefully video on demand, Blu-ray, and then I'd like very much for me on streaming sites. One of the reasons with the name of Fat Wreck, I was hoping in the festival circuit and online that people would see the name and kind of like Fat Wreck, and then see puppets and be like, what's going on here?
It worked. I mean, when I saw the lineup, I was like, Fat Wreck, what is this all about? Is it fat person that got in a car wreck or something? So it made me watch the trailer. It made me read the synopsis. So you did a good job on that. I have to ask, any merchandising with these puppets? Are you going to put them on T-shirts?
They'll definitely be like that logo on the flyer is something we want to do T-shirt-wise. I really like the way it turned out. The puppets, I've actually been offered $3,000 for the Mike puppet already.
You know, he kind of looks like Adam Carolla.
A little bit.
With the bushy eyebrows.
Yeah, he's got the bushy eyebrows. I think the mohawk price.
It's a punk rock Adam Carolla. Yeah, no, maybe?
I think so.
Because I'm looking at the poster here, and I see the side shot.
Squeeze his face a little bit.
Yeah. But Adam Carolla
has
bushy eyebrows and stuff. Okay, what are your websites, your social channels, and everything like that?
Okay, so it's really easy.
All right, I like that.
I have a background in marketing, by the way.
Oh,
so
awesome.
So it's a Fat Wreck. So the website, afatwreck.com.
Yeah.
Twitter, Fat Wreck. Instagram, Fat Wreck. And Facebook.com/afatwreck. Here's the other thing. So Fat Records website is fatwreck.com.
Yeah.
And so we're afatwreck.com. So
all the SEOs all built in there. That is awesome. I really do appreciate you joining us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, man. I really appreciate it.